and welcome to Off the Pulpit. I'm Andre Acha for Catholic SU Radio. Now, my dear sisters and brothers, if this is the first time you're tuning in to Catholic SU Radio and the first time you're catching Off the Pulpit, well, this is a program where members of our clergy come in and then we get them to discuss matters of faith. And of course, if we're lucky, we get to hear their personal sides of the story about, of course, the particular subject that we're talking about. Today, we have a visitor from outside the Archdiocese. We have Father David Bellusci. Father, welcome to Singapore.
Hello, Singapore.
Well, Father is a Dominican priest and friar, so if you haven't already noticed, he's also from Vancouver, Canada.
Yes.
Yeah. He's taught in Colombia, India, Rome, and South Africa. He's currently assistant professor at Catholic Pacific College in Canada. Right,
yes.
Vancouver, where he teaches philosophy, Aquinas, and moral theology, church history, and Catholic spirituality. Father Bellusci is also a keen and creative writer and poet who has published several books, and he is well known for his research into the life of Blessed Pier-Giorgio Frassati, a 20th century lay Dominican who is being held up as one of the patron saints of this year's World Youth Day 2023, which, if you didn't already know, is in the first week, that's happening in the first week of August this year. Now, in 2020, Father published the biography, Pier-Giorgio Frassati, Truth, Love, and Sacrifice. So, let's get it from the man himself. Father, thank you once again for joining us.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about yourself and about the work that you do and what brought you into religious life and the priesthood.
Okay, well, three good questions. First of all, I come from a Catholic family. And so being brought up from a fairly traditional Italian Catholic family, I learned at a very young age the value of religion, but not just, you know, recognizing the importance of God in our life, but also the importance of the family itself, the just family values. And so God, family, and then we have a certain work ethic. I was brought up with a certain work ethic, which led into my academic life and a life of studies, I guess you can say. And then from there, my vocation to the Dominican life, I would say, eventually developed so that I could continue my work, my research in one area that especially interested me, and that is God. God has fascinated me.
Wow.
Not just at a personal level, but just to deepen my knowledge of who God is and
right.
what we can know about God. So my doctoral work was on the love of God. What does it mean to say that I love God or that God loves me? We say this all the time.
Mm-hmm.
We hear it all the time. It's love is central to Christian values and the way we live our faith. But when we say love, what does that mean? So my whole doctoral dissertation, it's called The Love of God, or Amor Dei in Latin,
mm-hmm.
and focusing on the 16th and 17th centuries. So this eventually led me to—
Very Thomistic.
Yeah, well, yes, St. Thomas and also St. Augustine.
Yes, right, yes.
St. Augustine.
Right.
I also look at St. Augustine's writings. And yes, and so from there, my journey as a Dominican was developed, I guess.
Uh-huh.
And then I discovered as a Dominican, it was as a Dominican that I discovered Pier-Giorgio Frassati.
Ah, how old were you when you decided that religious life was for you?
I was probably a kid when I, this was, you know, when you come from a Catholic home, it's the idea of being a priest is almost like a normal thought. It's a natural thought, right? Because this is sort of what you're exposed to.
Absolutely.
We have saints all around our home. The Virgin Mary is present everywhere. Crucifixes. My father used to make a sign of the cross in front of a crucifix at the entrance of our doorway. So when you're exposed to this, the priesthood seems like
the most natural thing.
Exactly. Yeah. So it was always there. The big challenge was, all right, so you have a vocation. Where do you go exactly?
Right.
There are a lot of possibilities.
Absolutely.
And coming from an Italian family, I thought maybe I should go to Italy and join religious life in Italy. These kind of questions. I was doing missionary work in Zimbabwe as well. And I thought maybe I should stay in Zimbabwe and just enter religious life in Zimbabwe. This was also a possibility.
Mm.
So the discernment process was, in fact, the not so much discerning the vocation itself, but the community, the discernment process of the community.
Right.
Was very, that took some time, in fact, to find the right place.
Mm. Wow, wow. It was really a walk with the Lord as well.
It was, yeah, a walk with the Lord. You're right. And persevering. Just even at times you think, no, this is, it's not working out, or just being discouraged or being, you know, detracted.
Right.
Just persevering at the end, right? If you know that God calls you, then you stay with that call and you will find where God is leading you.
What did you do in times of discouragement?
Times of discouragement.
Well, how did you, you know, how did that perspective work out, you know, after going through what you went through? Did you say, no, look, I'm just going to forget about all of this, or am I going to persevere?
Yeah, no, never came up. That was not an option.
That was not an option.
That was not an option.
Beautiful.
I had, when I realized that God was calling me to consecrate myself, it was consecration to Him that came first. When I realized God is consecrating me, I still remember this was in Zimbabwe. During a mass, the Dominican nuns actually were the ones who were singing at that mass.
Wow.
And I decided at that mass, okay, Lord, I know you're calling me to consecrate myself to you. And I said, I promise I will consecrate myself to you. And so I would not break that promise. It was just a matter of knowing where is God leading me. But that promise I would not break. So to answer your question, because it's true, there are times of discouragement, frustration, yeah, and so forth. Having good priests you can talk to really helps. You know, my father was really good friends with a priest. And so that priest who was in Italy, I would write to him or call him, and that would help.
So you had a spiritual director miles across the sea.
Who was a friend of my father.
Wonderful.
So that helped. But also time alone with Christ and just, you know, before the Blessed Sacrament, just trying to make sense of where he's leading you. So, but that's perseverance. And it's one of the things about the saints. If you look at the saints, trying to find out what do the saints have in common is that they persevere. I mean, they do not, you know, we were talking about earlier how the Asian countries are really a place of martyrdom. Christianity has really known martyrdom in the Asian countries. But this is perseverance to the very end.
Yeah.
Martyrdom is perseverance to the very end. Like, they will not betray their faith. They persevere to the very end. So this is, I think, a hallmark of, you know, how we are called, all of us, really, to live our faith in perseverance.
Yeah. Which leads me to my next question, actually. So when exactly did you hear about Blessed Giorgio Frassati?
So this I remember very clearly. I was then a Dominican. I was the assistant novice master, okay? So I had novices, and I wanted to give the novices a good model for a life of sanctity. And I thought, okay, well, whom could I choose for this? Mm. So we had a library, and I went through the library looking at the different saints. And then I come across Blessed Pier-Giorgio Frassati. At that time, I knew very little about him. I didn't know what made him a Dominican, and I didn't know what made him blessed.
Mm.
So I thought, okay, well, I'm going to have to read up on him, find out why he's blessed and what is so Dominican about him.
Right.
And then I did read his writings, which are his letters to his friends published in English. But I thought there isn't enough here to say that this person should be beatified or that this person is even a Dominican. And then I realized what I needed to do was read the testimony accounts on Pier Giorgio. And his sister Luciana had collected all these testimonies on the life of Pier Giorgio. And as you read these testimonies, I read them all in Italian, as I had read his letters in Italian as well. Then you realize how modest and how humble and how discreet Pier Giorgio was. He did not say all the things that he was doing. He did not, you know, talk about all his pastoral activities and the way he was trying to help the youth, his fellow students, his friends, grow in their faith. A lot of that is not there. You find out through the testimony of his friends who wrote about him after he had died.
Wow. Wow. So during the beatification of Blessed Pier Giorgio Frassati, Pope John Paul II called him the man of the eight Beatitudes. Now, share with us why the Holy Father was able to, you know, sort of accord Blessed Frassati that sort of title. I mean, it's no small thing to you know, just say that. You know, it must really mean someone who's really, who has the attitude of Christ mm-hmm. with him.
Yes, I mean, this is certainly Christ's teachings, right? The Beatitudes on Mount Tabor, which the apostles really understood as what it means to live as a Christian. Pier-Giorgio Frassati, I think he stands out for a number of different reasons. The one that I just mentioned, there is this simplicity about him. Mm. There's a simplicity about him, this kind of meekness about him, this humility that also comes out in his writings, because he talks about some of his activities, but he always will engage the other. He will say, tell me your news. Tell me what you're doing. How are your studies going? We often forget about that. We're thinking about, you know, how I'm doing.
That's right.
My progress. And he's always asking, tell me your news. And this, he ends his letters asking for the other person's, you know, how are things going with you in your life? So this reflex to turn to the other all the time. Mm. So this kind of self-effacement, which is really what humility is.
Right.
We know for a fact, and this is how he died. He was very concerned, and perhaps this is what, you know, the Pope, one of the reasons why Pope John Paul II made referred to him as the man of the Beatitudes, is because Pier-Giorgio was very concerned about the poor in society, both in Turin, where he was exposed to significant poverty in the slums of Turin, but also his experience in Berlin in Germany. This was just after the First World War.
Right.
And so Germany was suffering considerably, and this affected the student population. This just affected the overall population, but Pier-Giorgio was in contact with the students, and he was trying to find out, how can we help the German Catholic students who are also suffering? He was always trying to find ways of helping the poor, those who are somewhat marginalized by society because of their economic conditions,
right.
and the, you know, the way they've been socially stigmatized and so right. forth. Pier-Giorgio was looking out for these people. He really had a sense of charity, and it was very concrete. He wasn't just talking about, we need to do something to help the poor people.
Right.
He was participating in what were called the St. Vincent conferences.
Ah.
St. Vincent conferences.
After St. Vincent de Paul?
Exactly. Yes. He was, there was Pier-Giorgio with others, and they would visit, they would go to the slums on Fridays, and they would visit those who were in the slums. It could be because they were not just poor, but they could just be people who were not their health. They could have, you know, some kind of disease and they were not being nursed. They could just be people who were neglected or forgotten, ignored, a whole array of possibilities in the slums. And Pier-Giorgio would visit them, even if it meant just talking to them,
right.
But often bringing them some kind of medication, what they would need to be helped. And in fact, he dies, you know, his death ultimately is contracting this polio, the polio which he got from through this contact
right.
in the slums. And this is eventually what led to his death.
Oh, dear. But just having heard you, you know, share about Blessed Pier-Giorgio Frassati, it sounds like he made himself present to people.
Mm-hmm.
That, you know, as you said, he always wanted to know how the other person was. It sounds like as though he made himself truly present. And today, actually, many of us fail to make ourselves present to others because, as you said, half the time we're thinking about, oh, you know, either I'm going to be late, or, you know, how long are you going to be rambling on, you know, and I've got to run. You know, very few of us allow ourselves to be truly, truly present to the other. And that's a sad thing. But it sounds like Blessed Frassati did exactly that.
Mm-hmm. That's actually a perfect word, present. Presence. Present. And that's exactly what he had done. Just as you had said, He made himself present. It wasn't as though he was delegating the work, because he had friends. He could have said, the only time he actually delegated something was when he was on his deathbed, because he couldn't leave his bed. But he still was able to write a note to a friend, Giuseppe Grimaldi. He left a note saying, you know, this is the, in my jacket, you'll find the injections that are used for one of the people in Turin who was suffering. He would bring them injections on a regular basis. And also this pontificate from a charitable service. They would use these pontifices to purchase items.
Right.
And on his deathbed, he's still thinking, not about himself, I'm semi-paralyzed here and I'm suffering. He's still thinking about the people whom he would visit, because it was a Friday when he died. He was still, and on the Friday he would normally go and visit the people, bringing them whether it's injections or pawn tickets or whatever they needed. And still then he is remembering that he has to bring these items to the slums, and he asks his friend Giuseppe Grimaldi, can you bring this to these two individuals? One is called Converso and the other is called Sapa. Can you bring this to them? So to his very death, he does not make himself present, but he still finds a way of making himself present, right?
That's amazing. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, how many of us would have been in that state of mind and that presence of mind? Actually, it's, mm-hmm. again, presence of mind, you know, making himself present, as you said. But I think it's the presence of mind. Wow, that is amazing. I think I should grab your book and really read up on it. Dear sisters and brothers, if you just joined us, thank you very much. You're listening to Off the Pulpit here on Catholic SG Radio. Today, we are truly very blessed to have Father David Bellusci. He is a Dominican and he is a friar from Vancouver, Canada. And our father teaches, he has taught. Are you still teaching in Colombia and India?
No, so in India, I'll be going back to Goa next summer. In fact, I teach philosophy in Goa. So depending, in some countries, I alternate. Sometimes in some places, the contract is over. But in India, I still continue to teach there in the summer months. I also work in Rome as a confessor full time in the summer months one of the basilicas.
Oh, wow.
So that takes 2 months of my summer when I'm in Rome as well.
Wow. Okay. Now, Father is he's well known for his research into the life of Blessed Pier-Giorgio Frassati, whom we are speaking about, a 20th century lay Dominican who's being held up as one of the patron saints of World Youth Day 2023. And just having listened to what Father has been sharing about him, I mean, this man sounds absolutely amazing. And that is why, I guess, he is a saint to be for the Catholic Church and for all of us. Father, I understand that, Blessed Frassati actually lived about 100 years ago. It's still considered still very modern, but social and cultural conditions were different then. If he were alive today still, what do you think his message would be to our youth today?
His message would be to be anchored in the truth, to be anchored in the truth, and to be anchored in the truth, because truth is not something that changes. I mean, as much as social, cultural elements can change at a very superficial level, truth fundamentally does not change. And Pier Giorgio, he definitely had a message. I mean, he was grounded in truth, which is the truth of the scriptures, which is the truth of church teaching. This is something that is non-negotiable, regardless of how long ago. Truth does not change.
Right.
Love fundamentally is something that does not change. It has its source in God.
Right.
So because love and truth both have their source in God, we cannot speak of these things as changing, as society might change and culture might change. So even if he were much earlier than the early 1900s, when we're dealing with saints, we're dealing with individuals who had died ultimately for the truth. And this is something that does not change. And that's what Pier Giorgio Frassati would say, to remain anchored in the truth, which is to be anchored in Christ. So truth in terms of how we live our lives, right? Truth is always translated into day-to-day living.
And, you know, day-to-day living, again, for some people, you know, a capital T, truth, we say is the Lord himself. mm-hmm. right? And it's Jesus. But again, the question is, how often do we ourselves, even as adults today, have the time to think about this sort of truth? And for us to live it out in our lives is just a whole different story altogether.
Yeah, so I'll tell you something. Teaching the youth, I teach at college in Vancouver, as you mentioned, and teaching the youth, I noticed there is a thirst for truth. There is a thirst for truth. They do not want, they don't just want to hear opinions. Mm. They don't want to just have an extension of what they're going to read in the mainstream media or the social media. They really want truth. And they almost right. can sense if you are not giving them what is true. There's a thirst for it. There's mm. a thirst for it. And when they hear it, you can sense that the students are saying, yes, this is what I want to hear. This, and then when you know what is true, then you can live in truth, right? You cannot right. live in truth if you don't know. First of all, we start with truth. Mm. This is like, if you want, our metaphysical foundation is yes. truth. And then from there, once you know what truth is, this is true for love as well. We can't really say that we love someone until we really know what it is to love in truth. Mm. Right, to love in truth, because, you know, love can also be what we would call an apparent good, right?
Yeah.
This impression of love, and the person, you know, following their emotions thinks, oh, this is love because yeah. of this fuzzy feeling that I
Absolutely.
Get. Is it grounded in truth? That is always a question that needs to be asked. So right. truth comes first, then we will be directed by what is true, and we can love what is truly an object of love.
Right.
And all of this, Pier-Giorgio Frassati, he lived it. He lived all of these things. He shared with his friends the Catholic faith. For him, it was so important to get his friends to heaven. And so as much as they had a good time together, they had their, this group that they created called the Shady Ones, the Tipiloschi in Italian, to have fun together, right? He wanted right. his friends to have fun. He said Catholics know how to, what joy is, and to live that joy. But ultimately, we need to be directed to eternal salvation, right?
Yes.
And this is where we're headed for as pilgrims, to eternal salvation. And this is what truth does. It gives us direction, mm. very clear, objective direction, which is ultimately God.
Truth and authenticity, mm-hmm. would you say it is the same, or?
I wouldn't say it's the same. Truth is really, at the end, it's something metaphysical, whereas yeah. authenticity is more personal.
Mm.
But there is something important about authenticity, because the youth will also be, and we've noticed this with vocations, the youth yeah. will say, I'm looking for an authentic community.
Absolutely.
Right? So in other words, here we're talking about something real. And when we talk about the real, we're still talking about true. Right?
Right.
Because as St. Thomas says, my intelligence, I exercise my intelligence when truth leads me to what is real, right? So reality is grounded ultimately in what is true. And so that authenticity that you're talking about mm. has the same, more at a personal level, but the same connotation, right? Being
right.
grounded in something that is real. And that's what, again, the youth are looking for, that authenticity.
Absolutely. Yeah. Just want to ask you, have you ever attended a World Youth Day celebration or gathering?
Believe it or not, I haven't.
Well, I believe I haven't. My daughter did, and you know, she thought that it was absolutely amazing. But from your experience and from those who have come back, maybe, what was their takeaway?
Yeah, it sounds from what what students have shared with me and young adults have shared. And it's always been a favorable experience. I think for Catholics to get together, the whole idea of World Youth Day, to come together from all over the world, to pray together, to worship together, I think this is, you know, an extraordinary experience. And I think it's really something, not to sound like a bigot, but it sounds like only something that Catholicism can do, right? Because we are a universal church, right?
Absolutely.
We are a universal church.
Absolutely.
We are, you know, present across all these cultures and united. It's not just a matter of being all over the world, but being united
Absolutely.
In a common faith.
Yeah.
Only Catholics can do this, right? And this is what makes the World Youth Day experience so great.
I wonder how many people appreciate that, though. Mm-hmm. I wonder how many people appreciate it.
I would say that with the youth today, given that there is so much confusion in our world, where there is division, there is fragmentation, mm. this unity If anything, it gives them the sense of it's great to be a Catholic. It's great to be a Catholic.
Something bigger than themselves.
Yeah, yeah.
Truly.
Yeah, clearly the work of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
At the end, it's the work of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen. Now, if we're talking about the youth and saints, for instance, and, you know, obviously, Blessed Pier-Giorgio Frassati, definitely. But if there are other saints that, or who could appeal to our youth today, do you have some in mind?
I recently gave a talk on also to a youth group at an institute in Canada, in Saskatchewan, and the talk was on Saint Maria Goretti.
Mm, yes.
Again, a very youthful figure because she tragically was killed, but a person again the value of what. What you live for. I mean, the values, again, values are beliefs. We live them, right? We live them. They're not just in our head. It means that when a situation arises where our values are being challenged, our beliefs, ultimately mm-hmm. our faith, which translates into our moral lives, our moral activities, where are, you know, are, how far are we prepared to go to defend them, defend our moral convictions, our moral rectitude, and so forth. And Maria Goretti, she was prepared to die
for her chastity.
She was prepared to die for her chastity. And she was knifed numerous times by this, his name is Alessandro, by Alessandro, who was just the next door neighbor. So they knew each other. In a way, they were already friends. But Alessandro took advantage of a situation where she was alone at home. And she would not succumb in any way to his advances. And then he finally threatened her, right? If you do not, you know, succumb to what I want, then... You know, I think it was a knife or a tool that he had, but he was prepared to kill her, and he did kill her, and she would not. She basically said to him, "What you want, Alessandro, is a sin, and I will. It's a serious sin, and I will not commit a serious sin." And she died. She was willing to die for that, and she died for that. But what was beautiful, again, in this case, that gives us a very Christian perspective, apart from willing to die for the value of chastity. Is forgiving him. Absolutely. On her deathbed, she says, "I want to see Alessandro get to heaven. I want to see him." So this is the beautiful part of her story. It's not that she wanted vengeance or her family wanted vengeance or that he should be punished, you know.
She was interested in his soul.
In his soul, "I want to see Alessandro get to heaven." And those were basically her dying words, was she wanted to see him get to heaven. This is very beautiful because it shows you, in spite of what he did to her, I mean, ultimately killing her, she forgave, not only forgave him, but she said, "I want to see him get to heaven." And most certainly from heaven, she was praying for him. And it was, the story is, in fact, Alessandro... because he is then sent to jail, they don't execute him because he's quite young. I think he was 19 years old. He's in jail, and in jail he has a conversion experience. And in this conversion experience, it's because of a dream he has of these. I think there were about 13 roses that just fall from heaven, and these roses, he's like, "Why 13 roses?" Those were like the number of times that he had stabbed.
Oh, my word.
He had stabbed Maria Goretti.
Oh, my goodness.
And then he realized what those roses meant, right? That they were coming from her and that she had forgiven him. This marks the beginning of his conversion process.
Wow. I believe he became a religious after that?
Yes, a lay. I think it was a Capuchin.
A lay Capuchin. Right. Mm. Wonderful. For your own devotion, Father, to Blessed Frassati himself, how has he helped or inspired your spiritual life?
Well, as a Dominican, I have a whole chapter on his spirituality, which is really his Dominican spirituality.
In your book?
My book. And I, you know, if anyone were to ask me what makes my book different from other books that were written on him, it's that I have a whole section on why he is his spirituality is Dominican. And so that helped me directly as a Dominican, because there are many things that he was drawn to. I mean, all the figures he was drawn to, Saint Dominic, Saint Thomas Aquinas, Saint Catherine of Siena, and even one who was not a saint, Girolamo Savonarola. He was actually a very controversial political figure of the 15th century who was executed because of his very controversial, fiery preaching and so forth.
Right.
But he was a Dominican also. And Pier Giorgio takes his name as a Dominican, Girolamo.
I see.
So he, taking all these Dominican figures, then you start to look at what is the, how does the Dominican charism express itself? And one of the things that we find in Pier Giorgio's life is that it is very connected to what is going on in the world. Right? Mm. The Dominicans do not shy away from what is happening and to respond somehow to what is happening in the world. It's not enough to say, well, you know, they'll work it out themselves. as long as I save my soul, this is what
matters.
No, how can I be engaged in the world to and for Pier Giorgio, that engagement meant making it more Christ-centered.
Wow.
Making it more Christ-centered. So we know this with St. Catherine of Siena. She goes as far as Avignon to persuade the Pope to return to Rome.
That's
right. We know with, you know, Girolamo Savonarola, how he was trying to redirect the Florentines to more Christocentric, really a society that would have Jesus as king. And with St. Thomas Aquinas, it's interesting. Many would think that Pier Giorgio Frassati was interested in St. Thomas Aquinas because of the Summa Theologiae, his great work.
Right.
Actually, it was his chastity.
Wow.
Yeah, it was his chastity. There was, he's known for this incident that occurred, St. Thomas Aquinas, where his mother really did not want him to become a Dominican. She was the one that sort of organized this with her sons to... St. Thomas, well, Thomas at the time was already being directed towards Dominican life. And he clearly made a decision to be a Dominican. And he, so the mother, with the help of the sons, has Thomas, St. Thomas Aquinas, abducted. And he's sort of imprisoned in one of the family castles, right? It's a fairly sort of a noble family. And with this, having him imprisoned, then he, the mother instructs the sons to send a woman to him. And this woman who will seduce Thomas then will have forgotten about his Dominican vocation.
Right.
Well, this does not happen, right? This does not happen. When the woman actually comes to the castle door, St. Thomas, in fact, takes the... takes this the stick that is used at the for the fire, because it's a fire. He takes that that stick, and then he chases her out of the room, out of his room, and then he puts a cross on the door. And so this incident is associated with the chastity of St. Thomas Aquinas.
Right.
And Pier Giorgio knows the story. There's also a cord associated with this. There's like a cord that girds St. Thomas Aquinas, the what's called the angelic cord. He's girded by angels. And so this cord, which Pier Giorgio was also familiar with, all of this attracted him to St. Thomas Aquinas. So essentially it was the purity, the chastity of St. Thomas Aquinas, rather than his academic work.
Right.
It was his purity that... also drew Pier Giorgio. So the poker, that's what I wanted to refer to. The poker was how Aquinas had branded the door with a cross. So at the end, these Dominican figures are inspire Pier Giorgio, whether it's for chastity, whether it's in the political arena, in the case of in two of them, and then the Marian aspect of it.
Mm.
You know, St. Dominic is associated with the rosary.
Absolutely.
And Pier Giorgio, since he was a child, was not just only praying the rosary, he was making rosary with rosary beads. So all of this helped, putting this chapter together, his Dominican spirituality, also helped me realize how these Dominican saints are a reflection of the Dominican charism, and how I, you know, how I'm called to live out my Dominican charism as well. And now I can add Pier Giorgio Frassati to the list as well.
Wonderful. So, I mean, in a sense, that's really, truly grounded you. And
oh, yes, yes.
Mm-hmm. It's mm-hmm. been an inspiration for you as well.
The aspect of sharing, making sure that, you know, it's because sometimes we can feel kind of satisfied with with our own personal growth and our spiritual life. But that personal gratification definitely needs to be shared. I mean, you need to reach this sort of reaching out to others that was so important for Pier-Giorgio Frassati,
right.
reaching out to his friends, sharing his faith, wanting to get them to heaven. So just a reminder that, you know, even if I find that I'm busy with different activities, that I should always be able to reach out to others and share that aspect of sharing the faith, right? That's so important.
It's always trying at least to go beyond ourselves.
Exactly. Yes, exactly. Right? Exactly.
Father, thank you so much. That's about the time we have.
Okay.
Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me. Yeah,
not at all.
Thank you.
So, dear sisters and brothers, thank you so much as well. We've been speaking to Father David Bellusci. Father is a priest and a Dominican friar from Vancouver, Canada, and he's taught in Colombia, India, Rome, and South Africa. And Father is also well known for his research into the life of Blessed Pier-Giorgio Frassati, a lay Dominican whom we've been speaking about and whose spirituality really was all about being present to the other person. Many of us, of course, struggle with this today in all our busyness, but we try, I guess, our best, Father. So thank you so much for joining us. And just a reminder, if you're listening to us on our live stream, Off the Pulpit goes out every 2 weeks on Tuesday mornings, and then that's at 8:30. And then the encore broadcast is at 8 p.m. the same day. And then tomorrow, Wednesday, 5 p.m. and Thursday, it's at 2:10 p.m. If you'd like to catch up on this interview at your own time, well, we have our Catholic SG radio apps, and there you can find this program, also on Spotify and Apple Podcasts. So once again, thank you, dear sisters and brothers. Thank you for joining me. I'm Andre Acha for Catholic SG Radio.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.